So this is a fascinating topic for a number of reasons. One of them is because we do lots of research on this area of IPOs, because it is really kind of a challenging issue, whether you should bring your company to the market or not, and what is going to happen when you bring your company to the market is a very big kind of problem. How can you ensure that your company is going to be successful in the market is a very big risk that you are taking. So let's start with the way I do my classes at CAS is really debates. I'm not there just to teach. I'm not there just to talk to the students. Otherwise, everyone will be sleeping, especially at 9 o'clock in the morning. So what we do is that we try to see, first of all, what are kind of the pros and cons of coming as an IPO to the market. So the idea here, please keep in mind that what we're trying to do is that you've got a company that is over here that is private. So your company is private, so you own it, or it could even happen that one big company owns that subsidiary, and that subsidiary is going to be quoted on the stock exchange. So the issue here is you are here private. It comes at particular time zero, like today or any time period, and your company now is going to be public. There are a number of kind of questions raised as to whether you would prefer to keep your company private or whether you would like to come to be quoted in the stock market. So usually we deal with this question by looking at the advantages and disadvantages of an IPO. So really here, what we are saying here is that this process here that comes at a particular time period is called the initial public offering, which we just refer to as IPO. So the initial public offering. We call it initial public offering because the company was not publicly quoted. So it is the initial time, the first time when the company is going to be quoted on the market. Okay? So in your opinion, what are the pros and cons of having your company quoted in the market? So let's start with the advantages. What are the advantages of having a company quoted in the market rather than having it kind of private?
Money.
I'm sorry?
Money.
Make money. You may make money, you may lose money.
You will have funds, additional funds.
Very good. Yeah, so raise money, raise capital. So that is really the big advantage, is raise capital. Raising capital is one of the reasons why companies come to the market. Having said that, you have to be very careful. A good number of companies come to the market without raising any funds, or without any raising funds for the company. In other words, they raise funds so that the entrepreneurs will get the money. Will get the funds themselves, but not for the company. So the company might not need really the money. Sometimes you raise money to pay debt, so it's not really for future investments. But in general, so we can say that companies can come to the market in order to raise money, to raise funding. What is the other advantage? What are the other advantages of coming to the market? Okay. What is the big advantage of trading shares? Okay, very good. So sell your ownership, and we call it in finance is to diversify your holdings, because you probably have done it when you did your MBA, is that the big concept in finance is that do not keep all your eggs in one basket. If you are the entrepreneur and you have all your money stuck in that company, you take very big two risks, in fact, that you take. What do you think are those two risks of having all your money tied up in your company?
It goes everything.
I'm sorry?
It goes to the wall, you lose everything.
Very good. So what is that everything? What are the two things that you lose more?
All your money and the company.
Very good. You lose your money, but also you lose your job. You are investing your savings, but also you are investing your human capital. So in other words, that if the company goes bankrupt, you are in very big risk of losing those two main assets that you have, the savings and also your human capital. So you lose your job. Okay. So in order to minimize this risk, you need to diversify. So therefore, you come as an IPO in order to diversify your holdings, in order to realize some of those gains and go and invest somewhere else your funds. Okay. So those are kind of, there are also the other advantages. One of the issues that you mentioned about trading shares is that you are going to have a value. You would know what is your company's worth. That is the critical issue. When you have it private, you don't know what is the value of my company. It could be 100 million, it could be 120 million, it could be 50 million or something like that. Okay? So the valuation here is critical in deciding as to whether you will stay private or you would come to the market and have your company quoted in the stock market. Okay, let's look now. There may be some other advantages that we keep later on. Let's look at the disadvantages. What are the issues that might refrain you from bringing your company to the stock market?
Short-term requirements.
Very good. Very good. So we call it short-termism. Short-termism. So in other words, that the market, I just write it MKT, if you allow me. The market might be just looking at what you report as earnings, what you pay as dividends. So therefore, it might not be valuing the long-term prospects of your company. So there may be a risk that the company is only looking at what you are going to report as earnings in a particular year, rather than what you are going to report in the future. So it might be that there are some ideas, although it is debatable, there are some concepts here, or there are some issues with the stock market that we might think that it is too short-termist. And therefore, by coming to the stock market, instead of raising capital, if I carry on here, for new investments, to invest in what we call your growth opportunities, investments in growth opportunities, that you cannot finance when you are private because you cannot get enough funding. In fact, one other big advantage here of coming to the market is that you will have a bargaining power. Bargaining power with the banks. Because when you are private, your main source of finance is a bank. You can get some venture capitalists, some VC funding, but in general, the big funds will come from your own savings as well as from the bank. So when you are quoted now in the market, you go to the bank, it refuses the lending, you say, no, I don't care. I go to the stock market and raise capital because I'm already quoted. But if you are private, you are tied up to the bank. The bank doesn't give you the money, you are stuck. You will lose investing in those growth opportunities. And as a result, the main reason for coming to the market is really to raise funds to invest in those growth opportunities. And usually you need lots of funds, you need lots of money to invest, to really kind of invest in those growth opportunities. But however, in some circumstances, the market may not allow you this. It might be that some people would say that the market is so short-termist that really when you come to the market, you are not going to invest in those growth opportunities. You are not going to invest in R&D. So all your money, all your thinking will go more into how much EPS, earnings per share, that you are going to report next year or next quarter or next 6 months, rather than what you are going to invest in the long run. So it might be, it is a debatable point, but it might be a big disadvantage there. Okay, what other disadvantages?
Loss of control.
Very good.
An emotional investment for you and your family.
Very good. Loss of control. You mentioned two main issues here. You had the loss of control and then the kind of the emotions of the entrepreneurs. Let's talk first of all about this loss of control. When you are private, You own 100% of the shares, roughly. Let's say that you didn't get any funding from VCs, but if you got some funding from venture capitalists, then obviously the venture capitalists will have some funding, but some stake there. And they may push you, in fact, to come to the market. But if you don't have those VCs, then the 100% of your holding is here in your hands. Nobody's going to take you over. You are the owner of the firm. You don't sell your shares, unless if you want to sell your company. But it's only if you want to do it that somebody else will take you over. But when you come here as a public company, you are open. Anyone can come and take you over. So there is a big market here for M&As, mergers and acquisitions. When you are quoted in the stock market, the decision is not only within your hands. It is within the hands of the shareholders. If the shareholders, they are not satisfied with you, somebody else is making a better offer, giving you a higher price for your shares, then the company will be taken over. So therefore, there is a potential loss of control when you are quoted as an IPO. But the other one is really the emotions that you have as an entrepreneur. When you create your company, you consider that company is your baby. So therefore, you don't want to get rid of that company. So you want to keep it here as a private firm. Okay? So you don't want to have it kind of quoted in the market because you feel that you are losing your baby. Okay? Now, when we do some research, we had a number of papers that are done in this area. And one paper that comes to mind is that they were comparing IPOs in Italy and IPOs in the US. So there was one paper that looked at whether there is any difference between the companies that come to the market in Italy and the companies that come to the market in the US. And what they find is that one focus that they looked at is the age of the IPO. So they find that on average, IPOs age in the US are about 6 years. So on average, from the time you create your company to the time when you bring your company to the market is about 6 years. Guess how long is this time in Italy? About 42 years. So the company is like an old man or an old woman coming with a stick until they are all wet. But what they find is that it's very, very unlikely that the first owner would bring the company to the market. It's only the second generation or even the third generation that brings the company to the stock market. Why? It's because of what you said here, because of the emotions. Because they are so attached to their company that they don't want to bring the company to the market immediately there. Okay, the big disadvantage is what we call the underpricing. Underpricing is the difference between the, if I just write some maths here, but it's very simple. It's the price on the first day minus the price offer divided by the price offer. In general, if we just take as very simple example that the price offer is 100, i.e. you bring your company at 100, take it as £1 or 100 pounds or 10 pounds, it doesn't matter, okay? On average, we find that on the first day, when your company starts trading, this is the average in the US and also in the UK, it's about 123 or 125. So it means that you have lost 23% of the value of your company when you come at the IPO. So this is the price at the IPO date, okay? So we look at the first time when your company starts trading. You brought your company at price of 100. Immediately, on the first day, it starts trading at 123. And that is what we refer to as the underpricing. In China, it's about 87%. So you bring your company at 100, but it starts trading at 187. So there is a discount, or what we call the underpricing, of 100 of about 23%. So the question is, so why is this? We find two main reasons that are contradictory. If this price is right, then it means that this price is wrong. So in other words, that the offer price is wrong. And it is wrong because of two main reasons. One of them is because we don't know how to value companies, and that is really what I'm going to discuss now. The second one is that it could be that at the time of the IPO here, you have got lots of underwriters, the investment banks, IBs. Those investment banks, you will recruit them before your IPO. You bring them at something like 6 months or 1 year even before you have the IPO, before the IPO date. Those investment banks will have the role, one of their roles is to value your company, is to get this price that I put here of 100. So if really the market price is right, then it raises question as to whether those investment banks that gave you the offer price of 100 got it wrong. They could have got it wrong on purpose because they want those companies to be underpriced on purpose, but they could got it wrong also because valuation is very difficult. So we cannot blame them straight away that it is their fault, that this underpricing is their fault. It could be because that the value in a company, in particular when you are a private company, is very difficult. Okay, and that is really what. The second one is that it could be that this price is right, and therefore this 123 is wrong. In which case we refer to as being the market is inefficient, the market is bubblish. The market is kind of overvaluing your company because it says, oh, yes, it's a very big company. It has got lots of kind of interests, etc. And therefore, the price of your company should be 123. They value it at 123. The market values it at 123. But effectively, the price is only 100. And therefore, what we would expect is that if you start with the price here, if this is your offer price of 100, at the IPO date, immediately on the first day, it increases to 123. And then what we notice is that the stock price starts coming down quite a lot, up to something like even sometimes below 100, or roughly just about 100 some years after the IPO. So the price of the IPO doesn't usually stay as this high of the first day price, but it starts declining for some IPOs, and therefore we can say that those IPOs really fooled the market, or the market was fooled by pricing this company too high. And that is really what I want you to, what this issue that I want to illustrate with the case of Facebook. So I hope you got this small introduction, although it's about 25 minutes, but I hope you got since it took most of the time. So let's look now at the case of IPO.
I appreciate what you're saying here, but this approach, isn't there a flaw in terms of a lower enterprise value beneath which this doesn't work? Because the junior markets and bottom end of FTSE, for example, yep, below, say, half a billion valuation, there isn't the ecosystem of analysts and interested institutional investors to come after this. This doesn't apply.
That's it.
And that's an important thing because a big problem with the economy at the moment are the SMEs that are lacking access to liquid equity markets.
That's
but
it.
You're not covering that. You're covering
Well, in general, this is on average, but we find that this underpricing, in fact, what I'm going to talk about Facebook, is even higher for bigger companies, for larger companies. But it is true that what we find is that for when those big, large companies, they are much more likely to be subsidiaries of groups. Like the, I don't know what example I can give, I forgot. The usual example that I give to my students is, I don't know, ICI, when it's split into ICI and Zeneca or any other. So those companies, when we have what we call an equity carve-out, so they are not kind of called immediately IPOs, but they are very specific. They are called equity carve-out or spin-offs. The difference is that equity carve-out is pure IPO. The group is going to sell the subsidiary and will get some funding. And the spin-off, they don't get cash. It's just really kind of giving to the shareholders the shares. In those two, we find that it's lower and the pricing. Now, it's not that much. But you rightly say that it is applies much more to smaller companies where it is very difficult to value them because we have so much what we call information asymmetry. Information asymmetries that it is very difficult to value those smaller companies, those smaller groups. But at the same time, large companies like Facebook are faced with another problem, with a really kind of psychological problem that Facebook is the world, that they have everything, and therefore it should be valued more than what it is really worth. And that is what I try to explain to you here. It's this case of Facebook is an interesting case because it allows us to debate those two prices. Which one is wrong? Whether is it the offer price that is wrong or the first day price? But more importantly, it's not only the first day, but when we go, a few days later, Facebook price really kind of came down about 50%, came down quite substantially. And therefore, in this presentation, I'll try to give you to broaden this issue to explain a little bit more about this the conflict between what the market thinks, that is the value of the firm, and what the investment banks think about the value of the firm. So here, it is a strange company because it's just created in 2004, when I was born. What I meant here is that it's a very, very young company. We have so much information asymmetry about the company. We don't know it too much. It hasn't been in the market for so long, really, to be able to assess its value. And the second characteristic is that it is giant. It is very big. It has got so many kind of users. Like those are the statistics up to March 2012, where they had now there are, I think, more than 1 billion users that they have. So it's quite a very, very big company there. If you want to learn more about the history of Facebook, there is this nice film which is called Social Network, and it's quite interesting to see how it was developed, etc. But they didn't get too much into the IPO issue. It's just really kind of focusing much more as to its development, its how it grew up to a certain level there. Now, I want to focus on this. On the 18th of May 2012, Facebook came at a price of $38. So that is what I meant here by the offer price, $38. Okay. So this one is $38. On the first day, immediately when it started trading, the stock price went up the first day it started trading at $45. So immediately you have got at the beginning of the trade, the stock price here, which we can consider as the first day price, is $45. So you can see that if you just focus on those two extreme prices, then you would find a huge underpricing. So there is a very, normally I should have computed it. I computed it somewhere, the level of underpricing. But this is a really kind of the cutoff. So if we start from here, they offered 2.74 billion shares, and in fact they increased the number of shares that they offered because they felt that there is so much demand, so they increased them by 25%. Now, the strange thing is that those companies, when we talk about valuation, I don't know whether you recall from your MBA class, we use a number of methods to value. I'll explain them later on, in fact. One of the common method that we can use is a kind of the PE ratio, or is the comparable, using a PE ratio. And a PE ratio, we take, say, the earnings of the IPO, and we multiply it by the PE of, say, the industry or comparable firm. And if we multiply those two, then we can find what is the price of your company, what is the value of your company. In general, those PE ratios, If you look at the, sorry, I didn't bring the Financial Times, but usually I teach with the FT so that I can show immediately my students what is the current or yesterday's PE ratio of those firms. You would find that if you look at the FTSE 100 companies, say large companies, you might find, I think the PE ratio is about 13. Okay, so if this company, your IPO, has got 100 of earnings, okay, then you multiply 100 by 13, so you find it that the value of your company will be 1,300. Okay, so it's relatively simple. The problem is it's not so much how to select those earnings, because you can play with accounting, etc., and then we can find what we call the sustainable earnings, and with those sustainable earnings, we exclude any extraordinary items, etc. We find those earnings that are sustainable in the future. So it's relatively just accounting practice, or we look at some deep accounting and we find what are really the sustainable earnings of the firm. The big problem is what is this? Is what is the PE ratio that we are going to select? For the case of Facebook, the PE ratio was 100. It's extremely high. I mean, how come a company that had just started trading, it's not long time ago, it wasn't even making so much profits. We don't know where these profits are going to be generated. We'd have this huge PE ratio. So there is some sign that with $38, the equivalent to get this $38, which I put here as this 1,300. So if we put here $38 here, those $38 here are based on a PE ratio of 100, which is quite substantial. So it means that there may be some overvaluation of your company, of this company, already at $38, okay? So that's the offer price, there may be some overvaluation. We use also alternatives, like for example, the price to turnover, the price to sales, or the mark to book, the marked value. So you take, for example, then the price will be equal to the book value of your equity, the book value of your equity, you multiply it by mark to book of the, say, industry, the average of the industry or comparable firms. When you do this multiplication, you find the price of your company. So if we use here similar to this is the mark to sales, market to turnover, then this mark to sale again for Facebook was 25. Again, 25 is extremely high, because what we find for the even FTSE 100 or even for the US companies on average may be something only about two or three times. So the market might be valuing only your turnover at two or three times. Yet, for this type of company, 25 was very, very high. And that led the company really to be valued at 104 billion using this valuation there. Now, the interesting thing is to look at the process and also at the pre-IPO. What happened? How did people value this company in order to get this valuation, or in order to get this valuation at the IPO date? So we look at the 2005, we have the Axel Partners that bought 12.7 million, that invested 12.7 million in the company. And they bought 12.7% of the shares in the company. That will give us an equivalent price, sorry, the implied value of the company of 0.1 billion. So 100 million, is that correct? Yeah, $100 million, okay? That is in 2005. Then you have this rumor that Yahoo is going to take over Facebook. They were going to buy the 100% of the stake and they were going to pay $1 billion for it. It means that the implied value of the IP of the Facebook is about $1 billion. So you can see just in 1 year, the price was multiplied by 100. It's is it 10? It's multiplied by 10. 10 times, sorry. I'm getting confused. I need to go back to primary school to learn my additions there. So it's multiplied by 10. It's incredible. How can a company with 1 year, just kind of in 1 year, it can be the price will be multiplied by 10. And then you have here again, it is multiplied even here by 15. So the Microsoft invested 240 million in the company, bought 1.6% of the stake, and therefore the equivalent The implied value is 15 billion. Then you have Digital Sky investments that were invested 200. Here the price has decreased, but then since then, all those investors, Axel partners again, increased the stake by 1.5% and they valued the company at 35 billion. Goldman Sachs invested 1.5 billion, bought 3% stake, and that valued the company at 50 billion. Before the company was trading, you can see that in 7 months' time, from January to July, the price has increased again quite substantially, from 50 to 80 billion. They were thinking in May, on the 14th of May, they were thinking about price range between the investment banks. I mean, say that the price range will be maybe between 28 and 35, which means that the valuation is between 77 and 96 billion dollars. And then they increased, one day later, they increased the price from 34 to 38 dollars. And that gives us a price of the value of 95 to 104 billion. So you can see here that this is really kind of worrying. How come a company can change its valuation that much? I mean, it's not only a matter of small amounts. It's not only small millions. It's billions that are involved here. Please go ahead.
What particular sector are they classifying this company as being at this
point? Well, normally it should be the technology company. So within technology, if it was in the 1999, 2000, we might think that there was technology bubble. So there were all the technology companies that were coming at high valuation. So we can say, okay, the market was foolish. So it was just going with us with this trend in this technology, high valuation of technology companies. But here we are in 2012, where technology is relatively disappearing. So here the problem is really kind of the problem of valuation, that it is very difficult to value companies. This is just an example, which is really might be too extreme, but in general, valuation is a big problem. Now, the problem comes more that so after when they quoted at 104 billion, I put here the value of this company is equivalent to the top 25 U.S. companies. It is more valued than Amazon, Disney, McDonald's, and Ford Motor Company, which have been for long in the market. But now, the interesting is what happens after. So after this IPO, look at what happens. So on on the 21st of May, the price decreased to $33. So they lost 13% of their value. 22nd of May, they lost 18% of their value. The 26th of July, they lost 37% of their value. And then in August, the 24th of August 2012, they lost about 51% of their value. So it's not only, I should have kept it. It's not only the value when the company was private. So all this valuation here that I mentioned to you was when the company was private, which is very difficult. We can understand that might be it is very difficult to get its valuation. But the worst is that even when the company had the IPO, it's still very difficult. The valuation of the company is kind of too volatile. It's very, very difficult to give us a very good value of the company. So my purpose here is to delve into a little bit into this issue as to what is really happening here. Why is this? Why is this problem? Why do we have this kind of difficulty of valuing the company there? Okay? So the first thing that we could do is to, you probably did it in your MBA, that when we value, when we look at performance of the company or valuation of the company, we cannot look at the company as a standalone. We need to compare it to other companies. So we need to look at what other companies are doing. Are other companies, comparable firms, having the same problem, or is it kind of an exception that we have here? So here what I did is take the price of Facebook, since it came to the market, computed what we refer to as the cumulative abnormal returns, which I don't know whether you have you have done it in your MBA or not, but when we look at the analysis of the market, the stock prices, the stock prices of companies, we don't look at the raw price. We cannot say that, okay, Vodafone is priced today at 180, and then yesterday it was 175, and the day before it was 179 or something like that. A price for us doesn't mean too much, because if we just look at price, we cannot compare companies. We cannot compare across companies. So what we do is that we look at the returns, the stock returns. The stock returns, which we compute as PT minus PT minus 1 divided by PT minus 1. So it's really kind of by how much is your stock price increasing or decreasing. So if the stock price is increasing, it means that the returns are positive. It means that your company is doing well. If this ratio here is lower than zero, it means that your company is underperforming. Okay? Is that fine? What did I forget here? Very good. Normally, we need to add plus dividends here, plus DT. Why do you think that I forgot it? I didn't forget it on purpose. I forgot it on purpose. I'm sorry? Very good. That is one good point. That's the... But what is another reason why we usually kind of focus much more on the capital gains, which is this bit here, i.e. the change in the stock price, which is really your capital gains, rather than adding the dividend yield. So the first reason is that because those IPOs, they don't pay dividends. The second reason is that usually the dividend yield is very small. I mean, if you look, for example, at the, somebody mentioned the AIM companies, if you look at the, again, unfortunately, I didn't bring the FT usually, I refer exactly to the FT. You look at dividend yield of the AIM companies, you find that it's about 0.3%. It's very, very small. But if you look at the FTSE 100, it's about 3%. Again, 3%, it's over 1 year. So it might be very, very small proportion. Thank you very much. So the one that I use is the second section of the Financial Times, and I look at those at the financial pages here, and amongst those financial pages, I don't focus on all the stocks because it is very difficult to analyze all those stocks. Sorry, can I just give this one? I focus much more on this table here, which is the indices. So you look at the FTSE indices, and then amongst the FTSE indices here, we have a dividend yield, one column which is dividend yield. And actually, if we look at the dividend yield of the FTSE 100, it is 3.45, but the AIM companies is 0.7%. So given that those companies are technology companies, their dividend yield is very small, we usually kind of put it aside. We say it's not too important for us. We just focus on the returns that is generated from capital gains. The third reason why we exclude dividends is that we add dividends only when the stock is quoted ex-dividend. So when the stock is... Sorry for this. Thank you very much. When the stock is outside the ex-dividend date, we don't get the dividends. So effectively, this dividend here is only added when the company announces here announcement of EPS and the DPS. But then here it's the ex day. So it's only on the ex day, on the ex-dividend date, that we compute the return on the company as PT minus 1 plus dividends divided by PT minus 1. Outside this ex-dividend date, okay, the dividend is zero, because you get it only on the ex-dividend date, when the company is quoted the ex-dividends. Okay? Apart from that, zero. So that's why, in general, we rely more on computing the returns on a company as the capital gains. So the return, the stock price today minus the stock price yesterday divided by the stock price yesterday. Okay? Now, if you compute those returns over a certain time period, like, for example, what I did here is over something like, I think the, how many months? About 6 months here. Over 6 months, you will find that going up, going down, you don't understand what is going on. In order to avoid this two fluctuation on daily returns, we compute what we refer to as the cumulative as the cumulative abnormal, and I explain what is abnormal, return. We add up cumulative means that we are going to add up those returns. So we add up the return of today plus the return of yesterday, etc. So what we are assuming here is that we are saying that suppose that you were, I put between brackets, foolish investor, because knowing that even some academics who did lots of research on this area, they still invested in Facebook and they lost quite a lot. Fortunately, I haven't. That's why I could afford to pay my ticket, my train ticket there. So suppose that you invested when Facebook came into the market and you kept that holding, okay? Now, up to August 2012, in fact, I checked even the price yesterday, it was still very low. It was about $26, so it didn't recover to $38, okay? You kept your holding. This is the return that you would have got. You would have lost up to 29th of August, you would have lost about 20% of your stake. So, sorry, 80% of your value, of what you have invested. So it is a substantial loss that you would have incurred had you invested in Facebook and you kept that holding up to now. You haven't sold them, okay? And that is how we measure really the performance of a company, is by computing the trend in its returns. Now, the important thing here is that this is the abnormal, because if you just look at the performance of the stock price, it's not enough. Because the stock price could go up because the economy is doing well, or the stock price could go down because the economy is doing badly. So you need to exclude this macroeconomic effect. Okay? We exclude the macroeconomic effect by computing what we refer to as the abnormal return, which we just write as AR, abnormal return, as the return on a company like Facebook, taking the price today, comparing it to the price yesterday, and dividing it by the price of yesterday, minus what we call the expected return. The expected return here, for simplicity, there are many models that we can use, we just take it as the return on the market, what the market has generated. So in this case, I have taken, I think, the S&P, the return on the S&P 500. So by excluding the return on the S&P 500, so you look at the index and you do the same. So the return on the S&P 500 will be the S&P 500 at time t minus the S&P 500 at time t minus 1 divided by the S&P 500 at time t minus 1. So you're just looking at the index. It's like you can replace this by the FTSE 100. The FTSE All Share Index, the FTSE AIM, any index that you think is relevant, it's just because the company was so large that I had to take the S&P 500. Okay, but I could have taken also the Nasdaq Composite, for example, as being the return on the market. So the abnormal return is the return on the company minus the return on the market, really the expected return, which we assume to be just the return on the market. You're just investing in the market, and that is what you are expecting to generate as a return, okay? Now, we accumulate those returns here, and we can find really the performance, the abnormal performance of the firm. So really Facebook, according to this, is abnormally underperforming, is getting lower returns. So in other words, that had you invested in Facebook, you would have got 80%, minus 80% of your value gone, comparing if you invested in the stock market, in the S&P, some companies in the S&P 500. Okay, so really the underperformance is quite substantial because the shareholders have lost quite substantial amount of their money. Now, compare this to Google. Now, you could say that maybe one reason, one kind of argument that you can put forward is to say that maybe all companies are behaving like that. It's not only specific to Facebook. So let's compare it to Google. So what I did here is to take also when Google came into the market on the 19th of August 2004. So exactly when it came. So look, had you invested in Google, you would have got really the price, in fact, was higher. So there is some enterprise in here. So you would have got a better return. While here, it's, you got just in a minute, when it, the first day when it started, but then it came down. It came down slightly, but then Google has done much, much better. So had you invested in Google, you would have got 60% above what you would have expect, what you would have got from investing in the S&P 500. So relative to the S&P 500, you would have done much, much better. So therefore, this graph here shows that really the case of Facebook is kind of strange. There is something that is going on. So I developed this set of factors that could contribute to this explanation. The first one is that it could be the investment, the investor sentiment that I think we mentioned it earlier. There was some issue here that maybe the investors are foolish. They just think that Facebook is very big. It's going to do very well. The second one, it could be the trading. So I analyzed here the trading. So let's see, maybe there are so many people selling the shares when Facebook was coming. The third one, it could be that what I gave you here is only Google, but it could be that Google came in 2004. Maybe it's not relevant. Let's look at some other IPOs that came up in 2012 and see whether this underperformance is specific to Facebook rather than to other IPOs. The same like other IPOs. The third one or the fourth one is the investment banks. Let's see whether investment banks really behaved properly when Facebook came into the market. The next one is the probably major shareholders are selling their holdings. You could see that the slide before that I gave you showed list of other big investors. It could be that they are selling their shares that drove the stock price down. The last one, which I focus much more, is this issue of valuation. That I want to keep you in mind that this is really the critical one, in particular when you have a companies like that, that are private, that have got high information asymmetry, but in any company, you will find a problem of valuation. So I will kind of refresh probably your knowledge on that, because I'm sure you have done it before, but we just see what is happening in Morrison. This first factor of investment sentiment relates to the new trend in finance that we call behavioral finance. That behavioral finance tries to explain anything that is happening abnormally in the market, in the stock market, or even within the companies, to some psychological effects. To say that really behavioral finance, there is a big questioning of one strong assumption in finance of rationality. In the sense that traditional or even modern finance, or even accounting, or even strategy, etc., we often assume that the managers as well as the investors are rational. Okay? So therefore, all what they are doing is for the good of the company. This rationality, which is really fundamental, which is a pillar in probably all the courses that you have done in your MBA, has led two main streams of research to challenge this rationality. The first one is what we call the agency conflict. And the agency conflict, I don't know whether you came across when you did your MBA, a guy called Jensen, who invented this, his main paper was in 1986, and the Jensen, the argument is that there is a conflict between managers and the shareholders, and even bondholders, in the sense that the managers in a company, they are not necessarily going to make all decisions that are going to maximize the wealth of their investors, or particularly the shareholders. Why? It's because they've got private benefit. Okay, so therefore, when they see that it is better to make a decision that is going to allow them to get higher returns, and in particular higher salaries, they will do it even though it's not good for the shareholders. And that is a really big explanation why M&As in general generate negative returns. Why M&As, they don't perform well. About 75% of them fail. Only 25% succeed in M&As. And we relate this decision here of taking over another company, which is mergers and acquisition, the failure of mergers and acquisition, really to this agency conflict, saying that the managers, they go and take over other companies, not to generate good returns to their investors, but to generate good returns for themselves. Okay, so that's really one challenge. The second challenge that came a bit much later, so this one roughly in the 80s, the second challenge that came a bit later is referred to as the behavioral finance. Behavioral finance doesn't accept the agency conflict. They say, no, the managers are still controlled by the board of directors. They are there with the AGM, the annual general meeting that controls them. They are worried that they lose their job. Therefore, they are not going to make what we refer to negative NPV projects. All the projects that they undertake could be positive NPV. However, when they undertake them, they don't know psychologically they have a break here. In other words, that they believe in something that they're really going to do very well. And this is one a big explanation that is coming up for this failure of the M&As is the overconfidence that the managers undertake those M&As, mergers and acquisitions, even though in the future they generate negative returns, not because they have assessed the M&A to be negative NPV project today, but because they have assessed it to be positive NPV, but they were too overconfident that they are going to do very well in those M&As. Okay, so this overconfidence, there is also the idea that the managers are herding behavior. So in other words, if your competitor is doing something, you will go and do it. So if your competitor is going to take over another company, you go and do it blindly, just because your competitor is doing it. Okay, so this herding behavior is also kind of the part of the behavioral finance, a new kind of theories that are developed there in terms of behavioral finance, trying to explain some decisions that are made by some investors or managers. And this is consistent with the Facebook. It could be that Facebook was bubblish. It could be that the price went up to $45 on the first day, and that this price went up well ahead of $38 because of the psychology of the investors. So the investors were thinking that, oh, this is great. We cannot make mistake. This is kind of it's an opportunity of lifetime. We need really to own shares in Facebook because we use it ourselves, and therefore other people are using it. But they don't know that there are many people who don't use Facebook. For me, I deleted the account of Facebook because I was getting so many requests from people I don't know, so therefore I just stopped it. But the youngsters probably, or other people, they just carry on using Facebook. And the psychology behind it is that if you use it, you think that other people are also going to use it. If you use something, therefore you think that other people are also going to use that thing. So you are not the only one using it. And this is very big risk. And that led probably that the psychology of investors led to many kind of increasing demand. That's why Facebook shares, they have to increase the number of shares by 25%. So that might be the reason why there is some this bubblish of the investors, which is driven totally by market inefficiency. In this case, then, we consider that the behavioral finance considers that market is totally inefficient. So as well as rationality here, the agency conflict assumes that the market is efficient. Efficient. So with this agency conflict, yes, there is no question about the market is efficient, and in fact it is punishing the companies that were not doing well. And therefore we need, under the agency conflict, we refer to M&A as a market for corporate control. For corporate control. So therefore the stock market is very good, is the one that will punish the managers who are going to make those decisions that don't create value. But with the behavioral finance, the market is not efficient. So again, it's something that you have done probably in your MBA. The behavioral finance totally challenges the market efficiency. And therefore, they were saying that all those price of that is quoted for Facebook is totally wrong. It's only driven by psychology. And therefore, as a result, that might explain the decline in the stock price. So the market were fooled, in us, the investors were fooled at once, but you cannot fool all the people all the time, as they say. Okay, so you fooled them once, but not all the time. So as a result, that might explain the decline of the stock price. Unfortunately, so far, we cannot test empirically this. It's impossible. How can you go and tell the investors, why did you buy Facebook shares? Well, so it's very, very, it's extremely difficult to test it empirically. So we leave it as being one hypothesis that we cannot test. Okay, but it's good to keep it in your mind because it might be relevant there. The second one is the investor trading. It could be that the drop in the stock price might be explained by the heavy trading of investors. So the company, in fact, just to give you some statistics here, the company had shares outstanding of 2.74 billion. That is what probably you did it in accounting. That is what you have as shares outstanding. But they issued and fully paid 1.3 billion. So in the market, there are only 1.3 billion shares that are trading, even though they have the 2.74. So they are really issued only 47.45%. The remaining shares, the remaining roughly 53%, are held by Mark and his colleagues, etc. So all the people, all the other investors there. So I looked now here at try to explain this drop in stock price, maybe by the trading of investors. So I found that on average during this period, up to 24th of August, from when the company has started, so the 3 months before, there were 38.6 million shares that were traded. So roughly 2.97% of the free float. So even if you take 10 days, so there were about 77 million shares just after the IPO. So it's 5.95%. So it might not really explain too much. There were some trading, but you cannot really say that there were 50% or 100% of the shares that changed hands. It's small, a relatively small number there. So another factor could be due to the fact that the bankers withheld some information. So probably if you recall, when Facebook came to the market, there was a big dispute that the investment banks didn't give enough information to the market. They were withholding some information. That might have made some investors nervous, and that may have led some investors to sell their shares there. Then also Nasdaq stopped trading because there were some problems with the trading of Facebook shares, and therefore they stopped trading the shares of Nasdaq. It could have contributed a bit, but I looked also at the IPO record, IPO date when the company came into the market. There were 550 million shares that were traded. But it really didn't affect too much the stock price. It only increased by 0.97%. So it's very difficult to relate this to the trading by individual investors. Another argument that you could put forward that I try to test is really the short sellers. Are there sufficient short sellers there that were betting on the price of Facebook to go down? So they borrow some shares from the investors who got those shares, and then they were trying to keep them, to sell them today, and then to buy them afterwards when they find that the price is going to decrease. So I went into the literature into short selling. I found this short ratio that was developed in this literature, although it's not really my area, but I tried to not put all my eggs in one basket. So I was not to focus only on corporate finance, but to go into even market microstructure literature. So the short ratio is the amount, the days for short sellers to cover their position. It's about 2.40 days. which you might think might be high, but on the other hand, you look at Google is 1.88, you look at LinkedIn is about 1.10, but Microsoft has got 2.83. So it might not be the case that really Facebook was subject to heavy trading by short-term investors, by the short-term sellers, the short sellers that might drive the price down. It's very unlikely there. So now I looked also at compared the trading by Facebook, the trading of Facebook relative to its float, again, and I compared it to Google. So if you look at Facebook, it's on the first day, they were about something like close to 13% of its shares. But then afterwards, it's really kind of relatively random here, something like about 4% on average or something like 6% on average. When I compared it to Google, it's relatively similar. So why Google share price is increasing while Facebook stock price is decreasing? So this is the trading volume of Google from the date of its IPO. So it could be that maybe even Google was subject to this this low trading, to this heavy trading that might decrease the price. But there was no evidence. But then you can ask question, Google came in 2004, so maybe it's not the same time. So what I did is I matched exactly the dates from as if Google came in as an IPO in 2012 here, and then I put this red line here, looking at the trading volume of Google. There may be some heavy trading in Facebook, but really cannot explain too much. I kind of hesitant to say that the trading by investors is the main reason for this thing. Another hypothesis that I looked at is the other IPOs. It could be that it's not only specific to Facebook. So all IPOs that came up in 2012 or even 2011 went down quite substantially. So therefore, it's something that happened to everyone. So I looked at this. And I stole this graph from The Economist. Please don't tell them, otherwise tomorrow I will be in prison. In fact, the university, we have the right to copy some graphs. Instead of doing all the analysis, I thought, oh, this is very good graph from The Economist. So what you can notice here is that there are IPOs that came up roughly in 2011 and 2012. So if we look at the LinkedIn did quite well. You know, that it generated good returns on the first day, and then it maintained that performance something like about 1-2 years after. If you look at the another company called Zynga went down a bit on the first day, but then it recovered, although it declined here. The group again might be similar to Microsoft. Pandora may be similar to Microsoft. So not to Microsoft, to Facebook. There. So we might think that it could be that Facebook is only following the trend of the other IPOs. And I put here also some other companies that that came up in 2012. I always joke with my students, telling them that if Manchester United loses, then you all fail. So they keep praying, and I think they are still praying that Manchester United will win the Premiership, and then they will all pass their exams. But I'm not sure yet. There is still some risk. So I told my students that you never say anything wrong about United, otherwise you'll be here next year, and you'll be here the year after. You always fail. So if you look at Manchester United, they came up in August 2012 at $14. They went down by minus 8%. You look at Glencore, they went down by 28%. Groupon went down by 37%. At the same time, the indices went up. Like, for example, the S&P went up by 11%, comparing to US IPOs that went down by 9%. In Europe, the market went up by 9% and the IPOs went up by 3%. In China, the market went down by 5% and the IPOs went down by 12%. However, the question here is that we cannot draw a conclusion that everything went down and therefore that could explain the underperformance of Facebook. So really kind of Facebook might be very specific. It went with the wrong ones. Why wasn't it like LinkedIn? I mean, it's strange why. So therefore, we cannot conclude effectively that really the end performance of Facebook is due to the fact that all IPOs that came during that period went down. There are some companies that went extremely good. I mean, I put just those examples here of Zigo and the DKSH. Please don't ask me what does it mean, but I think it is a Swedish or a Danish company, went up by 21%. Zigo went up by 32%, but the most one is really LinkedIn. Why Facebook really didn't follow what LinkedIn was doing in the stock market. So the next hypothesis is investment banks. I try to go very quickly through this. It could be that maybe that the investment banks contributed to the failure of Facebook. In other words, that what we used to say is that the investment banks can play a kind of positive or negative role, but when depending on their strength. So the IBs in general, in the pre 2007 or 2008, in the pre-financial crisis, we say that the investment banks are very strong. So they enforce the price of IPOs. And in particular, since the market appears of investment banks, since it appears to be kind of an oligopolistic, in us that you've got only small number of big ones, and everyone is trying to target those big ones. In fact, there was an interesting study, I don't know whether you, it's by Bro and Fawcett, and that is published, I think, in Journal of Finance in roughly 2008 or 2009. I've forgotten exactly what the date. If you are interested, you can send me an email. You have my email address in front. I think I put it. Yeah, they have my email address in front, and I can give you the reference. And what they did here is a survey of companies that had IPOs. So they surveyed a survey of IPOs, and it's not kind of looking at the stock price data or accounting data, etc. It's a survey which is not used extensively in finance, but there are some issues that we try to understand, and therefore we use sometimes surveys. Those surveys, they don't work too much because of the low response rate, etc. So what they did here is asking a set of CFOs of IPOs to tell them, why do you come as an IPO? But more importantly is, how do you select your investment bank? Normally what you would expect is that you select your investment bank on the basis of the price. You go to one, you go to Goldman Sachs, they tell you, oh, I'm going to take, something like 12% of your proceeds as being the cost, as being the price that you pay to us. You go to, say, Morgan Stanley, they tell you, I take only 10%, and therefore you choose Morgan Stanley. But what they find is totally different. What they find that the main reason for selecting an investment bank is reputation. Reputation in that industry. So it seems that the financial managers of the CFOs of IPOs, they are so kind of risk averse. They don't want their IPO to fail, and they decrease the probability that your IPO is going to fail by selecting an investment bank that is very expert in the area. Even though the cost might be very high, the cost in fact came really very, very low. If you look at this study, you see the bars there about the responses, the cost is totally irrelevant. So it seems that those investment banks have got very big power. They had power to set the price and to set the conditions for those IPOs, in particular the price at which they are going to bring the company to the market. And a set of studies found that the argument is that you might say that in the post 2007 they lost this power because of the financial crisis. So therefore now the investment banks might be weak. So therefore we can say that maybe now the managers, the CFOs of the IPOs impose the price, and they want to have as high price as possible to minimize this end pricing. Okay, so therefore it could be that the Facebook manager, the Mark, has set up this price of $38 and imposed it on the investment bank. I think it was Morgan Stanley and the others that I wrote the names of their investment banks. So there were about four or five, because it was consortium. It was a very big IPO. It cannot be taken only by one investment bank. So therefore, it could be this, but again, it's very difficult to relate it only to this issue, because even LinkedIn came up after 2007. So how come LinkedIn had very good price, very good performance, while Facebook declined? So in other words, it might not be the only the strong reason that that would happen. So here where I wrote the names of the investment banks. So the underwriters were the lead underwriter was Morgan Stanley. So that's the main one. But then the sub underwriters were Goldman Sachs and J.P. Morgan. But what happened here is that it was a funny case, because while Morgan Stanley was kind of getting some additional shares from Facebook in the over-allotment basis, so they were gaining in fees, the sub-underwriters, what they were doing is that they were shorting the stock. So they were selling to shorts, they were lending those shares to short sellers in order for the price to fall, to bet on this price to fall. So it's kind of strange negotiation that was occurring here between the lead underwriter and the sub underwriter. So it could be that maybe they contributed to this drop in the stock price. But again, as I showed you earlier, with the ratio, that ratio of short sellers, it's not too high, really, maybe to affect the big big problem, the big drop in the stock price. I just want to mention something here. During this period, what is also happening is that the investment banks, they aim for low offer price. And why they do this is there was a big study. If you want, I can send it to you if you are interested, by some guy called J. Ritter. He's at Florida University. You probably came across his name, and he does really lots of research on this on IPOs. And incidentally, he invested in Facebook, so he's poor now. he's poor and destitute there. So he, if you can go to his website and you find all those articles. And what he found is that he found something that it's called flipping. I don't know whether he invented this name or maybe this name existed before. The flipping works as follows. The investment bank knows exactly the value of your IPO. So knows, for example, that your IPO is worth 120. But on purpose, they're going to offer it at 100. So they will discount it by 20. Why? It's because by offering it at 20, at 100, they are going to give it, they are going to give those shares. So this is a problem, in fact, even investigated by the SEC, is the stock allocation at the IPO date. So they are going to offer those stocks, they allocate those shares to only their friends. Okay? But funny enough, what he finds is even worse, is that they allocate those shares to the IPOs, the managers of IPOs that they have underpriced previously. So in other words, what happens is that I negotiate with you. I can tell you that, okay, I will accept the price of 100, knowing that really my company is worth 120, on condition that tomorrow or next week or something like that, you are going to underwrite this company, you are underwrite another company, and you will underprice it, and you will give me shares so that I will make a killing immediately on it. So in other words, what those investment banks are doing is that they do this flipping by giving the shares, the shares of the IPO that they have underpriced on purpose, to the managers, the CEOs, the CFOs of companies that are that they will underwrite afterwards, you know, that they will discount afterwards. Okay? So it was strange, and in fact, that's why it was, I think, after this paper that the SEC started kind of looking at this issue of the allocation of IPOs. So we consider it as being one possibility why the price of the company might flow. You will have high-end price in here, because obviously the offer price will be lower, and that might lead to the stock return. In fact, if really this works, normally the stock return should go up instead of down, because you are bringing the company really underpriced. Okay, so therefore, but it doesn't really apply to the case of Facebook. It's not I put here the quiet period. I'll skip it because it's something else there. Okay, there are only two issues before we stop. The first one is the major shareholders may be selling at the lockup. So you know what happened here is that something again that is interesting for research, etc., is that when you bring your IPO, so you have your IPO date here, okay? At the time of the IPO, you are going to sign an agreement with the investment banker, the investment bank, okay, which is a lockup. The lockup will be on terms of proportion of shares and also the period. The lockup works as follows. You have at the time of the IPO, the insiders, who are really the CEO, the CFO, etc. We are really have lots of information. In order to ensure that this IPO is not going to be what we call a lemon, in other words, it will come to the market. If all the managers sell, the company is going just to go downhill, so they will cheat the market. The investment banks impose or have an agreement, we can say just have an agreement, for those insiders, which are, as I said, the CEO, the CFO, or board members, etc. Now, with the research that we are doing, is that we find that there is also this lockup on the VC or PE funds. So even if your company was financed by venture capitalists or private equity, they still have this lockup. The lockup means that over this time period here, you are going to hold, you are not allowed to sell the locked up shares. So for example, if Mark had lockup of, 20% of the shares, then he's not going to be allowed to sell those shares over this period. In the US, this period is 180 days. So about so this is the US on average. Studies showed that in the US the lockup period is about 180 days. So about 6 months, you are not allowed to sell those shares that are locked up. In the UK, we did some research and we find that it is much longer. It's on average 365 days. In fact, it runs sometimes up to 3 years. So that you are not allowed to sell your shares over between 6 months to 3 years. The average is about 1 year. So over 1 year, you are blocked. Your shares are blocked. So, but what happened here is that when this period expires, we call it the lockup expiry date, those investors now can sell the shares. And what happens if they sell the shares? The price will decrease. Because there will be so much money share, big block of shares that are going to be sold in the market. So you have two reasons. The first one is this big number of shares. The second one is the information that you convey to the market. That when you sell shares, you say, you are an insider. You are going to sell shares in your company. What are you going to signal? That your company is not a good investment. I am selling my shares in my company. I don't want to keep shares in my company. So therefore, there might be negative signaling to the market that the company that company is really bad. So we try to look at this and we try to see whether this lockup expiry really can explain the drop in the stock price, because there is drop here and therefore the you would expect the drop. Yes, there are some drops in the price decreased, for example, 7% on the 16th of August when the one lockup expired with 271 million shares were released. etc. So there are a number of kind of cases here that illustrate that the price might have contributed, but it didn't contribute fully to the stock price decrease, because the stock price decrease of Facebook was well before the lockup expiry date. So we could say that really what happened with Facebook is much more specific. The I just skip again those. There are just some details about those lockup expiry effect, etc. In fact, the question that we raise in the research is, why should the price really decrease even though the market knows that information? Everyone knows the lockup expiry date. So why should it just decrease on the lockup expiry date? It's a big question that we haven't understood yet. So for me, I think the main problem, so that just gives me about 3 minutes to conclude, is the main problem in this Facebook is really the problem of valuation, that we didn't know how to value this company, that it was a shambles. It was probably the wrong time to come to the market. They needed maybe a few years. You probably have done in your course at MBA, just to refresh your mind, to make you feel younger. So I'm just kidding, don't worry. You have a number of methods that you can use. You can use the DCF method, the discounted cash flow, which involved in forecasting the cash flows, having a discount rate, forecasting the growth rate, how much growth is your company, and then doing some simulation and finding your value there. There are the multiples that I mentioned earlier, like P/E ratio, the revenue-based or the asset-based, like mark-to-book. There are also recent transactions. You look at recent IPOs, what is the level of their end pricing, and then you price your company according to this. There are also some new methods, but they are really not very, very popular, called the real options, because they have a set of assumptions, therefore they are not applied fully. But at least you have those three methods that you can use. But for the case of Microsoft, it's very difficult to really to apply it because of this, the lack of information when the company was still private. So the company probably came up quite early in its stage, and therefore you have this big problem of information asymmetry that makes getting a good valuation of such companies is extremely difficult. So therefore, probably, as I said, maybe Facebook was kind of too early. I did hear some simulation really to explain this price of 100 billion. We ran out of time, unfortunately. But you can have a look at it. It's really kind of, what I did is that I took the online advertising in 2010 of 25 billion. I found out that the market share of Facebook was about 27% of this market. In 2015, it was expected to be 45 billion, the advertising in online advertising. If Facebook has got 27%, it means that in 2015 they would have got $12.15 billion of revenue from this advertising. I included some additional international cash flow that they could have got. So I assumed 14 billion of the cash flow that Facebook is going to get in 2015. From this total revenue, I applied the profit margin of 40%. So that gives you and then I applied also a P/E ratio of 25. I find a value of about $140 billion in 2015. You discount it something like at 15% discount rate, you will find something like $80 billion. Now, you can see that this process that I followed is questionable. Can we say really that Facebook is going to have 27%? It's going to maintain that 27%? Can we say that the online advertising is going to be 45 billion? So all this is subject to criticisms, is subject to kind of dispute. What we could do is really do some simulation and try to see If the revenue is not for 45, it might be 30, what would happen with the price of Facebook and get an approximate of Facebook price? You can dispute also this P/E ratio. Maybe 25 is too high or maybe it's too low. So it's all those factors here that we have in valuation that might be subject to criticism and that might lead really to difficulties in valuing companies for which we have low information. For companies for which we have information, you mitigate this risk relatively because your assumptions might be relatively true, might be real. But when you have companies that are so small, so young, not so small because Facebook was about 100 billion, it's so young that we don't have so much information, it really creates big problems there. So I just put here for discussing those assumptions that might not be too realistic. The high risk again, because the company is new, etc., that might mean that the discount rate should be even higher than 15%, than what I assumed there to be 15%. And if you assume a higher discount rate, then obviously the value of the firm will decrease. So this is just there. So it just left to me to say thank you very much for your attention, and I'm sorry I've taken too much of your time. Yeah. Thank you very much.